to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Remy. I am a sonography student. I'm about a year into a two-year program. So today I'm going to answer some questions that I get asked a lot about sonography stuff and like my schooling. The first question is, what testing did you have to do to get into your program? People oftentimes will ask me about a specific test and like, what did you do to prepare for this test or that test? And it's usually not the one that I took. For my program, the only test that I had to take was the Wunderlich, which is a cognitive ability test. It's actually used by the NFL and just like a ton of different employers in all sorts of different fields. So it's not anything specific to ultrasound, it's just a general cognitive ability test that my school uses for admissions. I think my program required like a 21 or a 22 to get in, something like that. And it wasn't really something that you could study for, it was like noticing patterns and spatial awareness, basically just how fast your brain makes those connections between things, because it was also timed and part of the scoring had to do with how many questions you got through in the time limit. So for me, that was the only test to get into school. Another question that I get asked a lot is, what classes do you need to take? So a lot of ultrasound programs have prerequisites, mine did not, but all of those classes that would otherwise be considered prerequisites were required in the first semester of the program, unless you already had them and could transfer in credits. So for me, those required first semester classes that were the equivalent of prereqs were anatomy and physiology, which when you get further into the program, pretty much every class is anatomy on sub-level, so that's very important to have that basic general anatomy and physiology class. And then algebra, general physics, because then later you have to take ultrasound physics, English comp, law and ethics, and medical terminology. Most of those were 8-week classes. I think anatomy and physiology was the only 16-week. Oh, and then it's not in the first semester, but we also have to take general psych, which for me was something I could transfer from my previous schooling. And I think some schools might have psychology as a prereq, but you really have to look at the specific program that you want to do to know if there's prereqs or not, and what classes you have to take for your program. So after you get those like generals, prereqs, whatever they are, done, some of the classes that you have to take are, like I mentioned, ultrasound physics. It's a huge one because there's a board exam that's all about ultrasound physics. And then various lab-based ultrasound classes depending on your specialty. So for me, my program specializes in abdomen and OBGYN. So like I had an intro class last semester and now I have an abdomen class and a GYN class. Next semester I'll have an OB class and just a variety of other classes that help me be more well-rounded. Like there's a small parts class, which is thyroid, testicles, breast, things that aren't necessarily like part of the abdomen scans, but things that people who are registered in abdomen also need to know how to do. My program also has some vascular classes because even though the vascular registry isn't part of my program, it's still something that a lot of graduates choose to get. And so they teach it again just to help us be more well-rounded. If you were in a cardiac program, you'd have a lot of cardiac classes. So all of those ones that I just mentioned are lab classes, which means you have like a lecture element to learn about the anatomy, and then a lab component where you're actually using an ultrasound machine and looking at it on another classmate or a volunteer. And then I will have internships, which if you are in any ultrasound program anywhere, you will also have internships. It's a very, very important part of any ultrasound program to get those actual real-world hours scanning, not just a classmate or volunteer, but an actual patient who very likely will have some sort of pathology going on with them that you get to see for yourself before you're hired somewhere and have to do it on your own. When you're in these internships, you're either scanning after a sonographer that's licensed, so they already saw everything, and then you're just kind of going after to see if you also find those things. And then as you progress, you might end up scanning first, and then they just go in and double check you. Either way, everything that you scan is getting scanned by someone who has the registry so that you can learn before you get registered and have to do it on your own. So that kind of brings me to my next question, which is, does your school help you find internships and jobs? And yes, absolutely yes. So my school is entirely responsible for finding those clinical sites for those internship hours. So that's either a clinic or a hospital where they will let you work directly with a sonographer. And if for some reason one clinical site didn't work out, like if they weren't giving me the scan hours that I needed or something, then the school would find me a new placement to help me get the education that I need. And for jobs, they're also very helpful. Career services at my school is amazing. You might have seen other videos where I talk about my job as a patient transporter. I probably wouldn't have had that job without my school. The Career Service Center completely redid my resume for me to make it like a medical field resume, because it was kind of just a mess before. And they sent me like a list of job openings that they thought suited what I said that I wanted. And these were jobs that I couldn't find on Glassdoor or Indeed. I don't know where they found the postings for all those jobs, but it was very helpful, and the one that I ended up getting has worked out very well for me. And I've heard a lot of really good things about them helping people find career jobs for after they graduate, so I have high hopes for them to help me with that as well. But so yes, the internships are entirely on my program defined, and then jobs, I get help from my program as well as from our excellent Career Service Center. So 100%, so much support there. Not worried about finding a job after graduation in the slightest, because I just know that my school is going to help me so much with that. The next question is, are you able to work while in school? Which the answer is yes, because I have a job as a patient transporter, but it's not easy to work a ton while in school. You know, everyone's life outside of school is a little bit different, and everyone, I think, needs a different amount of studying, but it's a big commitment even when you're not physically at school. I am so impressed with one of my classmates who works full-time, even like gets overtime sometimes. I do not know how she does it. I think she does some of her homework at work, but still, just I could not handle that. I'd say that probably half of my classmates just don't work at all because they really just are focusing entirely on school, which is probably a smart idea if you have the option, which of course not everyone has that option, because people have rent and bills and whatever. But yes, I work a job that is PRN, or as needed. I don't know what PRN stands for, it's like some Latin phrase, but it means as needed. And so I am not placed on the schedule at my job. When I want to work, I call them and say, hey, can I work these hours? And they kind of always say yes, because they always need people. So it's very, very nice for me to have that flexibility and figure out like, oh, I've got a lot of homework tonight, I shouldn't work. Or, oh hey, I'm pretty open tonight, I might as well go to work for 4 hours or go to work for 8 hours. And so I am so, so, so grateful that I have that opportunity to be able to be flexible in that way. But yeah, again, it's one of those things where everyone is different. And yeah, it really just depends on your needs and if you need to work or not. If you have the opportunity to not work at all, then amazing, don't work. Because then you will have so much more opportunity to get as much scan time in as you want, spend a lot more time on your homework and studying. And yeah, I mean, if you have the opportunity to not work, then don't. But realistically, a lot of us do have to work, and so each person kind of has to figure out for themselves how many hours you can handle working. I still don't know how people work full-time jobs. That's mind-blowing to me, because most of us can't do that while in school. Oh yeah, so the next question is, how much do you have to study? And I've gotten this question a few times, and it's so vague. It's like, I'm sorry, but I don't know you. I don't know how much you have to study. Every person is so, so, so different. Everyone learns differently. Some of us learn a lot in lecture, listening to the instructor, and some people absorb very little that way and need to go home and kind of reteach it to themselves to actually absorb the material. I think that if you're, you know, trying to go to school for sonography, you've gotten through high school, you probably know what your study habits are like and what you need to do to be successful. And if you weren't as successful as you would have liked in high school, then you're gonna have to commit some more time to school than what you used to do. But everyone's just so different, so that's a very hard question to answer. And yeah, my answer is just it depends, I guess. And the last thing that I get asked all the time is about tips for studying physics and preparing for the SPI. The SPI is the first board exam that you have to take to become a sonographer. It's sonography principles and instrumentation. So it's mostly about physics and how your ultrasound machine works. So I took it a little over a month ago. I would really recommend this service called X-Zone, like X-Zone. I did take quite a few different practice tests from quite a few different sources, and that one I did find to be the best one. A few of my classmates and I were able to share a subscription, so that worked out really well for us. It was a lot cheaper that way. And to be honest, there weren't even like that many questions on it compared to some of the other practice tests that I took, but the ones that were on it were so, so, so similar to what was on the SPI. I think that helped me more than anything. But because there aren't a ton of questions on it, I wouldn't pick a subscription that's like a very long time, because you probably don't need to keep studying the same exact questions for a super long period of time. I would just do it very close to when you're about to take the SPI. Get like the, I think 5 days, what my classmates and I did. I think there were longer ones available, but we didn't really think that that was necessary. And all of us who shared that subscription passed on our first attempt. So I think it worked. As far as like what subjects to focus on, I would say know all of your resolutions, your axial, lateral, temporal, spatial, elevational, contrast, all resolutions. Know about all of your different types of phantoms, like tissue phantoms, Doppler phantoms, and like all the different things that they're used for, and all of your Dopplers. But yeah, I think practice tests was the biggest thing that I did to study for the SPI. And then after I took them, I looked at what areas I did the best at and what areas I did poorly on. Like, I think I was really good at the resolutions, but I needed to study more of the Dopplers, and so I made sure to focus on the areas that I didn't know as well. So really pay attention to what you already know so that you don't keep wasting time on the things you already do know, and figure out what your weak areas are so that you can improve those. But that was all the questions I had for this video. I'm sure I will make more videos like this in the future because I always get a ton of questions. So if you have any questions that I didn't answer and you'd like me to answer in the future, make sure to leave it in the comments. But as always, thank you guys so much for watching. I really do appreciate it, and I will see you in the next video. Bye!